Welcome back to Anxiety Slayer. I'm Shan Vanderleek. Every week, Ananga and I offer a holistic, compassionate approach to managing anxiety, drawing upon our many years of experience. We aim to equip you with the tools and practices you can implement immediately to alleviate symptoms of stress and anxiety and cultivate a sense of calm. Welcome back, Ananga.
Hey, Shan.
So good to be with you this week. Before we get started, we'd like to give a shout out to some of our new patrons. Thank you, Margaret, Chloe, and Wendy. We appreciate your support. If you'd like to become an Anxiety Slayer patron and unlock a world of support, guidance, and inner calm, plus more than 200 downloads, you can join us at patreon.com/anxietyslayer. This week on the podcast, we're answering listener questions about some of the practical anxiety calming strategies that we've been sharing over the last few weeks. We're incredibly grateful that you continue to send us questions, and for all of the folks in our private Facebook group, thank you for all of your sharing. Let's start with the first question. I've tried diaphragmatic breathing before, but I struggle to do it consistently. Do you have any tips for incorporating it into my daily routine?
That's such a common experience, isn't it? When we're trying to bring any breathing or calming practice in, that we sometimes forget or we struggle to be habitual with it. I think it's really helpful to set aside specific times each day to practice. The easiest way to do it is to do it as soon as you wake up in the morning and just set that time. That's when I like to do my first breathing practice of the day. You can make it a habit where you go and get a cup of hot water or whatever you do to start your day, and then sit and practice some breathing. Really good way to have a nice calm start to the day.
And to keep your cortisol down, or to get your cortisol down in the morning, if you can. I mean, even if you start breathing while you're still in bed, mm-hmm. is helpful.
Yeah, we've had so many questions about morning anxiety over the years, and you know, many of us experience that rush when we get up from bed. You've been laying down for hours and then you stand up, and that can cause some events in the body that the mind can flag and start exhibiting anxiety. So it's a great thing to even sit on the edge of your bed, practice some breathing before you get up, or go and splash your face, get a warm drink, and sit in your favorite chair and breathe for a couple of minutes, 2-3 minutes, and just start your day with that active self-care.
Mm-hmm. And then if you need help with reminders, set alarms or notifications on your phone that just prompt you to take a few moments for breathing exercises throughout the day. And please know, this isn't a lot of time. It's not that you need tons of time to do this practice. Even 5 or 6 or 10 rounds of your breath count and can make a difference. I have sticky notes on my computer, on the refrigerator, in the bathroom that remind me, that just say breathe.
Yeah, I remember you mentioning that in a recent episode. I have an app on my phone, which I've shared several times, a habit tracking app where I tick off my calming practices throughout the day. And I also have a paper journal. Really nice journal. You can set weekly intentions and priorities. What are you focusing on this week? So I'll always have some healing practices there, along with reading goals or other things that I like to check in and set those intentions. Mm-hmm. And in the evening, I sit with that paper journal and I'll tick off what I've read, what I've been meditating on, and self-care practices. And my goal on my app is I have a little tally count on this habit track app, and it's to have 6 check-ins a day where I do something for self-care. That could be breathing, a salt bath, taking a walk, some qigong, following a guided meditation, whatever it is, 6 little check-ins during the day, various lengths of time, anything counts, even if it's a couple of minutes. That can be really helpful, but it depends on the way we feel motivated. So it's quite personal. It might be checking in with a friend and having accountability, or making a cross on your calendar and trying not to break the chain where you have a cross on the calendar every day. And it's like, yeah, I did this for myself today. So it's quite personal what works for you, but have something that inspires you to keep it going.
And lastly, integrate your diaphragmatic breathing into the activities that you already have planned.
Mm.
This is something so easy to add to your yoga practice, or if you like to do a stretching practice, or if you're listening to calming music, you could invite yourself to breathe through a full song.
Yeah.
Anything that makes it feel a little bit more natural and enjoyable. There's something about just getting on the yoga mat and resting in Shavasana and just breathing deeply. It's such a gift. Even if you just do that, it's wow.
Or child's pose, or get your legs up the wall, whatever feels good for you. Something I like to do is when I go to make a cup of tea, my kettle takes a good couple of minutes to boil. So I'll do some bouncing on my heels, qigong, shake my body out, especially if I've been sitting, studying or working and I haven't moved for a while. I'll shake out and that goes on. That counts as a tick on the six things a day. 50 bounces on my heels and shaking out, something we've shared before, a qigong move for shaking stress and anxiety from the body. Or I might just put one hand on my belly and one on my chest, take some deep breaths, just waiting for the kettle to boil. Have a look out the window, look up at the trees, look up at the birds. We can feel more anxious and more low when our physiology is focused down, which we often are if we're working or reading or looking at our phones. So I'll take that opportunity to look up out the window and just change my state and, you know, just waiting for the kettle to boil. So like you said, integrating it with all kinds of things. You can practice deep breathing while you're listening to an audiobook or while you're in a warm bath. Just bring that extra check-in. Are my shoulders around my ears? Is my mouth relaxed? Am I clenched anywhere? How can I soften up? And can I use this time to just take a few deep breaths? Even at a stoplight, you can take a few deep breaths. And the more we do those micro relaxations during the day, the less anxiety can build in our body.
Thank you. We hope that that's helpful for you and that you continue to practice your breathing exercises. And thanks again for the question. The next question that came up is, the 5-4-3-2-1 grounding technique sounds interesting, but I'm worried I won't remember to do it when I'm feeling anxious. How can I make sure I remember to use it in those moments? It's interesting how these two questions are really about how can I remember and how can I make this a part of my regular practice. And it just is, it's practice. And it's creating these little reminders and whatever it is that works for your brain and your particular way of learning and practicing to move forward with these practices and to not be hard on yourself, but to just be, oh, you know what? That's right. This grounding technique is something that's a part of my Anxiety Slayer toolkit. Okay, I'm going to go to my notes and see what's involved in those. I'm going to look at what's involved in those. So the answers we're going to give you here are very similar to the first question, but just a little bit different. And I'll pass it along to you, Ananga.
Yeah, I mean, I like the point that I'm worried I won't remember to do it when I'm feeling anxious. For me, that's what's different with the last question. And my response to that would be, do it when you don't feel anxious. And you'll feel less anxious, for one thing,
right?
Because you're taking good care of your nervous system. But also, if you do it enough and you get a feel for it, it will become second nature to you. We soon learn things that bring us some comfort and some release. So when we get familiar with these techniques, then they're there for us and it becomes second nature. But we have to practice and we have to train ourselves to do it. Otherwise, it's like being a firefighter when you're not trained and somebody just gives you a hat and a hose and says, go put the fire out. And we won't know how to do that safely. So we need to practice ahead of time, make it familiar, make the technique your friend. You can practice when you're out on a walk, just practice as part of your walk. And then your walk becomes a healing, mindful practice that really benefits your nervous system. Practice before you go to bed at night as a way of relaxing into sleep. Practice in the morning with a sense of curiosity about your surroundings to help you be present in the moment and stop your mind flying off into future unwanted thoughts. make it familiar. And then if anxiety escalates, you'll have it there and you'll know what to do.
And again, you can create visual reminders if that's helpful. You could even write just 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 on a piece of paper. Or how about this? Get outside.
Yeah.
Get outside and do the practice. And oh yeah, I already love being outside. And there's so much for me to key in on. Whether it be the bird song, whether it be the leaves that are starting to show up, whether it be the ground underneath your feet, and so on, right? And so this is a kind of a twofold bonus, because being outside is grounding anyway, whether you're remembering the exact technique. If you get outside and breathe deeply and be in that space of awareness, oh my goodness, you're going to feel so good.
Yeah, it's mindful, it's present, and it's grounding through the senses instead of our senses bringing us chaos and disturbance, as they often do. They can bring us peace. And that nourishes the mind. Ayurveda teaches, India's ancient science of life, teaches that when we use our senses in this way, it brings nourishment to the mind. It's more healing than we often realize. So we spoke about this technique and exactly how to do it in last week's episode, if you want to gain some more detail. But basically, it's a technique where you're using your senses to notice things you can see, things you can hear, things you can touch, things you can smell, and things you can taste. So that's a great thing to do in nature. I have a small woods next to where I live, and I really like to go there and just see what I can notice, what bird song can I hear. Sometimes just walking and hearing our feet connecting with the earth is really helpful for anxiety. It's very grounding. And it helps us be very present. It's the easiest thing when you're living with anxiety to walk through a beautiful place and miss it all and just be kind of disassociated and spaced out. There's so much to be curious about. And this is a beautiful technique for doing that. And again, if you have children, especially if you have children that are anxious or worried about school or something, do it with them. Teach it to them. And it will be so helpful for them.
Curiosity is such a gift and an incredible, honest, beautiful way to take you away from what you're worried about and bring you back into what you wonder about. This show is sponsored by BetterHelp. If you had an extra hour in your day, what would you do? A lot of us spend our lives wishing we could carve out more time for ourselves and often feel like we simply don't have the ability to claim this kind of spaciousness. One of the best ways is to add something to your calendar to identify what's important to you and make it a priority. Both Ananka and I have made this a regular practice for years, and it's our way of making our self-care a priority. What will you create time for? Therapy can help you learn to set boundaries and uncover what's important to you so you can enjoy more of what brings you joy. It isn't just for those who've experienced major trauma. If you're thinking of starting therapy, give BetterHelp a try. It's entirely online, designed to be convenient, flexible, and suited to your schedule. Learn to make time for what makes you happy with BetterHelp. Visit betterhelp.com/slayer today to get 10% off your first month. That's betterhelp.com/slayer. Moving on to question 3. I'm intrigued by EFT tapping, but I'm not sure how to start. Are there any resources or tutorials that you recommend for beginners? Actually, we have several resources. We have online classes. We have tapping sessions in our Patreon and several podcasts that we've created. So just give yourself a little bit of time to do some exploration there, whether you go to anxietyslayer.com or whether you visit our Patreon. There are also, of course, many other ways to learn EFT tapping. And you're sitting right now with somebody who's written a book, one of the very first books on EFT tapping. So I'm going to pass that along to you, Ananka, so you can share a little bit more about how to get started.
firstly, it's so easy. Our mind can make quite an obstacle of learning new things. Tapping's really easy. It doesn't take long to learn. You can learn it in 5 minutes. It's really easy. I wrote a book some time ago now, about 20 years ago. It's called The Art and Science of Emotional Freedom. And it's available as an ebook on our Patreon. You can download it and read it as a PDF document. And it has diagrams and case studies and examples of how to use tapping. It has different scenarios, different ways you can use tapping. For example, tapping through a story to put it to rest. And there's some research in there of the different tapping points and their significance. Sometimes you'll hear us on the podcast. Last week we were talking about the collarbone point, for example, and that being on the kidney meridian. So in the book, there's a chart tracing all the meridians, and it gives the significance of the tapping points. On Patreon, we've also got some guided SOS tapping sessions, which are about 5 or 7 minutes long, and we tell you exactly what to do to follow along. So it's very worth learning, and you can't do it wrong. You can just learn to do it really well, but there's no wrong with tapping. It's still going to help.
And then there's another book that's also helpful called The Tapping Solution by Nick Ortner. I found that that was a good introduction, along with your book, of course, The Art and Science of Emotional Freedom. And thank you for making that available on our Patreon.
It's my pleasure. Nick's book's available on Amazon, widely available. And there's another gentleman called Dawson Church, Dawson, D-A-W-S-O-N, who's written some books and some information. Don't let your mind trick you into thinking it's complex and something you've got to figure out, because it's not. It's easy.
One of the things that I like about Nick Ortner's book is that there are just so many valuable setup statements that help you kind of get into the flow of crafting those on your own and getting started. But we've also shared many of those as well. So if you're truly intrigued by tapping, we've given you a number of places that you can start. And then finally, our last question of the day. I appreciate the tips on incorporating these anxiety relief techniques into my daily routine, but I often find it challenging to stay motivated. How can I maintain consistency in practicing these techniques, especially when I'm feeling overwhelmed or unmotivated?
I've been practicing meditation for nearly 40 years now. And I can share that my mind can still be very hard work every morning when I sit down to meditate. It can object. It can feel unmotivated. And then there's other mornings. This morning was a sweet meditation morning and my mind was cooperative. And that was so much easier. Yesterday, it was really hard going. And sometimes it's just like that, the nature of our mind. It can be so our enemy, as the wisdom teachings in the Bhagavad Gita state, our mind can be our best friend or our worst enemy. And it tends to default to being our enemy. So it helps to start small and just do it anyway. That's my method for dealing with my mind is, okay, your hard work today, we're going to do this anyway. And we'll both feel better for it when we're done. Just do it anyway. Start with small goals. Set a timer for 1 minute. It's always starting, isn't it, with everything, really. If we're trying to write something or tackle some work, we can have that procrastination that comes into our mind. And we all know it's just starting. So start with something small, easily achievable. Just a minute. I'm going to set a timer for a minute and I'm going to sit and practice whatever your chosen technique is. And once you start, you'll feel the benefit and it's easier to keep going. But that's something I think we all are challenged by throughout our lives.
Yeah. And if you find yourself saying, I don't feel like it, just kind of give yourself a little pat and say, that's okay. We're going to do it anyway. We're going to do it anyway. We're just going to do it anyway, because that's my go-to is, I don't feel like it. But then every single time I push just beyond that, I don't feel like it bubble, I'm so grateful.
Yeah.
And then I get to that place of that leads directly to tracking and say, okay, today I did it. Today in my app or in my journal, I did it. And then I can continue to look at that I can bring myself back to focusing on the benefits of what I'm doing and the positive effects that these techniques have. You can visit our Facebook group and see how many people are chiming in about the good things that have been happening since they've been practicing and incorporating EFT or breathing or whatever. We just had a beautiful testimonial come in recently in our Facebook group, and I'm just going to grab it really quickly and share it with you. And it was, "The simple technique has given me a powerful tool to alleviate stress and regain control over my emotions. With just a few minutes of tapping, I feel a sense of calm wash over me, easing the grip anxiety can have on my mind and body." I mean, right there, that's a reason to just go for it, even when you're feeling unmotivated.
Yeah, and gathering inspiration like that can really help with motivation. And then again, track your progress, as we've already said. Look at your motivation style. I'm a person who doesn't like to break the chain. Every day I read a chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, and I've been doing that since November. I could tell you how many days that is because I've got it on my app with a little flame by it, which means I haven't broken the chain. 154 days. That makes it very easy for me to read every morning because I don't want to break that. I don't want to lose my flame, but that's my motivation style. Again, you can put crosses on the calendar, or you can just go to bed at night and say, "Today, I'm glad I did this for myself," and set the intention to do it again tomorrow. So yeah, know your motivation style, gather inspiration, and ignore your mind. The mind's like a petulant child. Just ignore it. It's going to object. Some days I feel like I've dragged my mind around kicking and screaming all day long, but I know if I do the good things and the right things by it, I'll feel better by the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. I've also found that accountability is helpful. My husband and I will share our goals for self-care, whatever that may be. For him, it's doing 100 sit-ups a day. For me, it's moving, getting out, going for a walk, getting my daily walk in, and then checking with each other and celebrating each other when we actually follow through with something that is important to us, even when we don't feel like it. There's something sweet about that encouragement and that "good job, mate," and that, you know, "keep going," that keeps you sticking to your practice. We also have built-in rewards that might be something that you do. As if I do EFT tapping for a week, my reward will be whatever, maybe a beautiful bouquet of flowers or whatever, a cookie, whatever it is that makes you happy, that you can say, "Ah, you know, I'm going to give myself this gift because I've stuck to this."
Yeah, I love to sit down in the morning with a hot cup of tea and read.
No.
Yep.
I'm kidding.
It's true. In the quiet morning hours, that's such a joy to me. And there's things I pledge to do before I do that. So you can also have short-term goals as well. I'm going to do my meditation. I'm going to do some breathing. And then I'll have something lined up that I'm really looking forward to reading. I'm going to make a cup of tea and sit and read this in the quiet and just soak that in. Again, it's just knowing your motivation style. And sometimes we have to trick ourselves a little bit, but whatever it takes.
Yeah, whatever it takes. And also to remember that there are so many different approaches to calming anxiety, and we've shared many of them with you, and you can experiment with what you've learned. So if you're struggling to stay motivated with one technique, for instance, if tapping just isn't the thing for you today, maybe that deep breathing exercise is, or maybe grounding is where you want to be today, or what have you. Just kind of move through the strategies and variations, and you will find something that resonates best with you. And then knowing that you can switch in between is also helpful, because then you're not going to be in that space of judgment and being hard on yourself because right now tapping doesn't suit you or doesn't seem to suit you.
Yeah, and that's where guided meditations are really helpful, because it doesn't require anything from us other than a willingness to close our eyes and relax and listen.
Yeah.
Yeah, when we're really overwhelmed, sometimes even tapping, although it's great for overwhelm, But it can feel like something to do when our overwhelm is really heightened. So if that doesn't feel like a good fit for you in that moment, have some guided meditations ready and then just listen and follow along, and we don't need to do anything. It's kind of done for us.
You shared a beautiful quote from Catherine May in her book, The Electricity of Every Living Thing, that I think ties to this beautifully. I stuck with meditation because I was desperate, but also because it brought so many good things. Within a month, people were saying how much I'd changed. I was calmer, less inclined to rage. I was able to focus. For the first time in my working life, colleagues started telling me I was good at my job. It was an odd experience to be perceived to have reformed. Inside, I felt like I had continued to be myself, if a lot less afraid. That's really potent.
Yeah, she's one of my favorite writers.
I can see why.
Yeah, beautiful writer. I'm very transparent. And yeah, so she's sticking with it. And she's saying, because I was desperate, and sometimes with anxiety, we feel desperate. We feel desperate for help.
Sure.
But if we find something and stick with it, then the change will come. It's just being patient and sticking with it over time.
Incorporating these practical techniques for anxiety relief in your daily life, they're going to take some time in practice. But with patience and persistence, they really can become valuable tools for managing anxiety and improving your overall well-being. Please reach out for additional support or resources if you're struggling to implement any of the techniques we share. And remember that it's okay to ask for help on your journey toward better mental health. You can access all of our guided tapping sessions at our Patreon, where you can get a deeper dive into some of the topics we cover, as well as over 200 downloads, including all of our guided relaxations and guided tapping sessions. If you're interested in becoming an Anxiety Slayer patron, you can learn more at patreon.com/anxietyslayer. Thanks for listening.